I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Say those three things with me one more time. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Today I want to speak briefly on our consecration moment on this subject. Finish strong. Finish strong. Finish strong. Finish strong. Finish strong. Look at this scripture, y'all. Philippians. Philippians 3, 13 to 14. Now, there's three things you need to understand if you're going to finish strong through this consecration period. Three things you need to understand, all right? Three things you need to understand. Philippians 3, 13 through 14. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended. Oh, but I don't know if you got the other version. No, that's it. Okay. I'm sorry, y'all. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the call, for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Next slide. Three things you need to do if you're going to make your way through this time of consecration and finish strong. The first thing you need to do is focus. You got to focus, because there's going to be all kinds of distractions trying to get in your way to stop you from not following through on this consecration. Paul said this one thing, you got to focus. We got to be focused, y'all. Somebody say focus. Don't let the distractions get in your way. We are in time of consecration. There's going to be plenty of distractions. Somebody going to say something you ain't going to like. All of a sudden, everybody's birthday in church, on the job, they're bringing all the food in. Well, I didn't know it was your birthday. Huh? Somebody going to invite you over for the football game before it's time for you to eat, because it's playoff season. Huh? So you got to be focused. This one thing. Amen? What's number two? You got to be disciplined. You got to be disciplined. Forgetting, reaching, pressing. Forgetting, reaching, pressing. You may have messed up. Forget about it. You may have messed up. I know there's been some times of consecration, times of fasting that I messed up. Forget about it. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, forget about it. Forget about it. You messed up, okay? Forget about it. Forget about it. Now it's time to reach for the end of the line. Amen? Forget about it. So forget about it and reach, and there will be days you got to press. So you need some discipline. I am not turning on that show today. Today, we will not be doing that, flesh. All right? No, we are not going to the buffet. I know that's our... Somebody, what, did I hit it? Did I hit it? Did I hit the soft spot? No, we're not doing the buffet. We are going to be doing salad today, flesh. Amen? Uh-huh. No, I'm not staying up late, because I will be getting up in the morning for prayer. So, flesh, we will lay here at 9 o'clock and we will go to sleep. Because we're going to get up at 5 o'clock and have prayer with the rest of the brothers. You got to forget, right? You got to reach, and you got to press. You need discipline. What's the third thing? Motivation. You need some motivation. What are we doing this for? Paul said, I am doing this because I know there's a prize. He said, I press forward with a prize. There's a prize. There's a prize, y'all, in doing all this. This ain't just for show. This is a prize. You got a prize, a heavenly prize. And what are some of the prizes we can receive? Father, what are some of the prizes? Anybody want some peace? Anybody looking for answers? A great time to get some answers, questions answered, I should say. I'm sorry. Great time to get some questions answered. Strength. Anybody need some strength? I need some strength. Power. Anybody want a fresh anointing? Huh? A fresh outpouring? What's some other prizes? Revelation. You want to go into his word and see something that you didn't see before? Understand something you didn't understand before? Great time to get revelation. Lastly, a couple other things. Patience, endurance, and joy. Now, lastly, let me show you what a consecration looks like. All right, anybody want to know what a consecration looks like? Pastor, would you mind standing up here for a quick second for me, please? Come on up, sir. Stand right here. Amen. Stand right there. Come on up. Come on up. Stand right there. Can I borrow you, sis? Come on, stand right here. Stand right here. I'm going to show you what a consecration looks like. Elder, stand up right here. Sis, right here. Pastor, stand right there. I want you all, you stay right there. You're right there. All right. Let me show you what a consecration looks like. Let me show you what a consecration looks like. Amen. I need one more. Come on up. Come on up. Come on up. One more. I need one more. Let me show you what a consecration looks like. Amen. I'm you. This is what a consecration looks like. I'm you. This is your life. Right here. And this is God. All right. And this is the Lord. Everybody say, hey, Lord. All right. Let me show you what a consecration looks like. See, all through life, we got all this stuff in our lives. All this stuff in our lives. And God is standing at the end. And here you are. You want some answers. You want some peace. You want some joy. You want some strength, but it's all the way at the end of the line. Because you got all this other stuff. Family, friends, money, success, career, pride, ego, selfishness. Y'all didn't know y'all was all that, did you? Yeah. Guess you won't sit in the front no more, will you? You got all this stuff. And here you are trying to live this life with all this stuff between you and God. And you ain't giving him the time. You ain't giving him the relationship, but you want it. See, consecration is this. Uh-huh. See, that's consecration. That's consecration. See that? That's consecration. Hallelujah. I want to get in his face. Hallelujah. I want everything out the way. Turn over my plate. Turn off the TV. Get the radio out. Get the family out. That's consecration. That's consecration. I want to be right in his face. Somebody been looking for an answer and you ain't got it yet. Get some things out the way. But let's not make this just for 30 days. See, let's just not make this for 30 days. Let's turn this into a lifestyle. This is who we are. This is how we live. We live a consecrated life. We don't put nothing before God. I will let nothing separate me. Nothing. Nothing. Tell your neighbor, get it all out the way. Hallelujah. Give God a hand, praise. Finish strong. Finish strong. Finish strong. Finish strong. There ain't no time to give in. There ain't no time to give up. Focus. Discipline. Know you got a prize at the end. Hallelujah. Now, we also have our consecration information, different types of fast and consecration you can go on. Seek God's face if you need instructions. We have some instructions if you need some help, some information around that. We have booklets to assist you. You are not alone. That's the other thing. Call when you feel weak. Call somebody. Call somebody. I'm feeling weak right now. So we have these as well. Amen. So please let us know if you need them. Please let us know. Somebody raise your hand. Somebody raise their hand. Ah, here we go. Here we go. Amen. Pass those around. Elder, would you mind? Amen. Amen. All right. Also inside your booklet is the warfare prayer. Warfare prayer. If you're feeling weak, call somebody and let's pray. Hallelujah. Let's pray. And we got warfare prayers from Psalms for our church during this time of consecration. You can do this. Don't listen to the devil. He's a liar. He ain't never told the truth. Now can't tell the truth if he wanted to. Hallelujah. So make sure you use your warfare prayers from Psalms for our church as well during this time of consecration. I'm telling you, you will come out stronger. Hallelujah. You will come out stronger. So don't give up. Finish strong in Jesus' name. Amen. Finish strong. Lastly, when we do finish, brothers, when we do finish, I don't know if it's on that slide. I don't think it's on that slide. When we do finish, we will be going out to dine together. We'll have some more information about that as well. Amen. Some more information about that as well. All right. Oh, it is up. Okay. It did come up. So, brothers, we're going to have our first annual Breaking the Fast dinner. Amen. We're going to get together. So we have some flyers and information around that. So make sure that you get one of those flyers for that as well. Amen. Somebody give God a hand, praise. Hallelujah.
We've been a very busy church. And I just want to highlight some of the things that we accomplished in 2016. Just to let you know that this is a partial list. There are many other things that we did. But we had men's fellowship breakfast, FCLO worship, bowling party, and other outings, human trafficking forum, mentoring seminar, family and friends international day, healing and deliverance services, community of churches, upper room prayer. We have Path to Peace with resource agencies, women against rape and domestic violence, muffling nursing home visits, St. Francis Nursing Home, prayer summit at Drexel Hill Middle School, TGIF. We have MSI prayer walks, witness branch, Candace prayer breakfasts, new members fellowship, all-night prayer, juvenile justice training, evangelist training, global day of prayer, Candace women in white luncheon, honoring, that was very special to me, honoring the senior mothers of our church, school of prayer training, health fairs. We had multicultural outreach, graduate Sunday, family fun day, global praise outreach, Hallelujah night for the youth. Amen. Thanksgiving community dinner for the community. And all of the municipal officials came and attended that. We've been very busy as a church. We have accomplished a lot of things, and we're looking for more accomplishment in 2017. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Yeah. Give all the hand clap. Tomorrow is a very special day. And on this men's day, we honor a very special man tomorrow. This is the birth of Dr. Martin Luther King. Dr. King was a prominent civil rights leader who remains the most outstanding symbol of that movement. A movement that led voting rights for African Americans and into legal employment discrimination, segregation of public facilities. King won the Nobel Prize in 1964. And his birthday is now a national holiday. Amen. Yeah. When you get a holiday, you're somebody. King's success was in elevating the issue of equality into a moral crusade. He appealed to the conscience of the nation and brought pressure on the federal government to pass legislation that remedied many of society's inequities. This eloquent, stirring orator was able to convince people of goodwill that justice is inherent in the civil rights cause. He galvanized people of all colors, particularly massive number of blacks, and he galvanized them into actions that were fraught with danger. Indeed, these actions cost King his life when he was assassinated April the 4th, 1968, at the age of only 39. In this environment, there are forces trying to reverse his great work. We must be vigilant and diligent to keep the legacy and the memory of Dr. King alive. Amen. Amen. Those of you in particular who can come to the Martin Luther King breakfast tomorrow, it's at 8 at Drexel Brook. I would like to encourage you to attend. It's at 8 o'clock. It's only $20. But we need to support that man. And the word has been that even though they're having the breakfast about him, our community has not supported that as they should. So if you can get there, especially those of you in Upper Darby, if you can get there, if you're in Upper Darby or Drexel Hill or close by, see if you can get there at Drexel Brook tomorrow. Come on. Amen. All right. There's a prophetic word that I want to read to you that I think is appropriate for us as a church and where we're going this particular year. It's a prophecy from a young lady that we minister to who God is using mightily in the Atlanta area. And this is what she says. Those who are seeking first the kingdom of God this year are going to see an acceleration. You're going to advance faster than you ever advance. You will find angelic assistance on your journey, and you will need it. One assignment will come after another. At times, you'll have to more than one assignment that will come. The warfare will always be the next level, but you will defeat one enemy after another. After another, after another. And the blessings will come in rapid succession. Each time you finish an assignment, each time you conquer your spiritual foe, you will see a new level of blessings in your life. You will see, as you stand your ground, as you obey my leading, and so, as you seek my heart. That's the prophetic word for 2017. I receive it. I just got word. I want you to pray for the Long family. I just heard Eddie Long died. I just got that word. He had cancer. I didn't know that. So if that information is accurate, it's accurate, Janelle? It is accurate. So be praying for the Long family. Amen? Amen. All right, God bless you. How many of you are looking for God to bless you in 2017?
Before I begin, this is Men's Sunday, and Pastor did mention it. Because we were just trying to see how long somebody was going to say today is Men's Sunday. Every third Sunday of the month is Men's Day. Okay, so I had to write down some stuff here because I don't want to say the wrong thing. Y'all know me. trying to stay on course. We're talking about men coming together. This mentioned this morning, Mornings with Men. And we also have a group on Monday, tomorrow night, every Monday from 7 to 9 in the evening called Gabor. And I had to write this down because I always want to say something else. It's an acronym which means God-inspired brave brothers of righteousness. Okay, so that's what that Gabor means. And we are there for each other to help peel off the layers that so many of us walk around with. We are becoming more transparent as we come together. And as I said this morning, brothers that hold things in, you're holding on somebody else's strength. Regardless of how bad you may seem it may be to you, but to somebody else, they may be strengthening for them. So we as men, what we do is lock shields and we become transparent. We share. There's certain things that we just don't share with women, but we feel very comfortable when we come amongst one another. You know, and one of the main things that works against all men, and the brother said it this morning, which we always talk about in Gabor, is isolation. Isolation destroys a lot of us. You can't do that. You know, it's like, and we always make the analogy of you have a herd of animals, and when the tiger or the lion, whatever, decides to attack, what he does is chases the whole herd. But then there's always one that veers off. That's the one he's going to get. So to brothers who like to isolate themselves, you can't do that. You got to stay together with the herd. You're much stronger when we are together. You are weaker when you try to do the lone stranger. You know, and many of us do that. We're good with that. Okay, we are very good with that. But we cannot make it alone. God made it, so we need one another. We are all part of a fabric woven together. In that fabric, we got some worn out places, you know, but we're still a part of it. So we need one another. Monday night, Vince, we had 20 brothers come out last night. Last Monday, right? It's about 20 of us. Yeah, but the bad part about it, most of them weren't from this church. But we did have some brothers here. So we're still saying, brothers, if you're not doing anything on Monday nights from 7 to 9, please come out. Because this will encourage you. This will uplift you. You know, it'll let you know that you are not in this thing alone. We need one another. Okay, and my show, Making a Difference. Three Wednesdays of each month from 6:30 to 7. And I am going to have some flyers made up so I can, because people have been asking me about it. And I'll hand it out to you so you can catch it. You know, it's a men's show, but it's women, anybody can listen to it. Okay, but it's all about making a difference, telling brothers how they should be. I'm using the Kingdom Man book, which we are using in Gabor also. Okay, so, and I'm not just talking from the top of my head, the scripture and everything in that too, so I'm not just flapping my face. Okay, and we already mentioned the men coming together, right? We're gonna, which is February the 4th, so we'll be able to do that. Okay, so I'm done. God bless. That was good. You ready? And as we all know, we must give the one and only, the one who created and made all things that you see, and that you don't see. And we must praise him in every chance we get. Praise is what I do when I wanna be close to you. I lift my hands in praise. Praise is who I am. I will praise him while I can. I'll bless him at all times. And I vow to praise you through the good and the bad. I'll praise you whether happy or sad. I'll praise you in all that I do, because praise is what I do. 'Cause I owe it all to you. Praise is what I do, even when I'm going through. I've learned to worship you. Know my circumstance doesn't even stand a chance. My praise outweighs the bad. I vow to praise you through the good and the bad. I'll praise you whether happy or sad. I'll praise you all I go through, because praise is what I do. 'Cause I owe it all to you. We love you, Lord. Hallelujah. We can do nothing without you, Lord. We are nothing without you. That's why I say, praise is what I do. It's what I do. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Praise is what I do. Oh, Lord. It's what I do. It's what I do. It's what I do. Yeah. Praise is what I do. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Is praise what you do? Oh, really? If praise is what you do, convince me. Hallelujah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. sliding. Wow. Hallelujah. Charmaine. I'll need somebody and praise and show enough what you do. If praise is what you do, I want you to stand up and show me what you do. Let the devil know what you do. Ha! Ha! It's not what I do sometimes. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall magnify the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Praise is what I do, y'all. You don't know like I know what he's done for me. So praise is what I do. It's what I do. You may be seated in the house of God. Oh my. We're warming up for our speaker. We're getting him ready. Getting it ready for him. Our speaker is one of my elders. I consider him a son in the gospel. He's a pioneer member of Fresh Anointing Christian Center. And a lot of times you don't see him sitting up front, because he's married to somebody that's very dear to my heart. His wife, Ilar. And he sits there and he supports her. And he takes care of her like nobody I've ever seen. He put the H in husband. I've been to the hospital and heard him sit there and see his wife in writhing pain. But he was right there and supporting her and praying for her. He's a consummate man. And he has a heart for the disenfranchised. People that we sometimes reject and walk past. He's in charge of our homeless ministry, and he has done an excellent, excellent job. He really has. But he's also a man with a word today. I've known him for years, and I know he has word. So without further ado, as we say in my old church, I present to you my son in the gospel, Sonny Adens. Yes.
Y'all are too kind. This ain't gonna be easy for me. You guys have help me. You guys have been so kind, and you have blessed us, me and my wife, so in so many ways. when Pastor first asked me to preach, of course I never want to. I gotta be honest. But I already knew he was gonna call me. Because God is on my case. I don't know why. I don't possess anything special that nobody else has. I'm not good with the mic, all right. Donovan told me. I'm not used to a mic, but I'm gonna do my best. I wrestle with the word that the Lord gave me. Because the Lord usually does me a certain way. Now, believe it or not, I preach all the time. At home, I just can't help it. I get full up of the word, and it has to come out. And then God usually gives me, like he deals, every minister and even every servant, God deals with you in certain ways, right? So I'm waiting on the Lord. Lord, I ain't got nothing to say. Lord, when are you going to give me what to tell the people? Usually it's easy. So I'm thinking, I said, well, maybe I'll do my, I love the Holy Spirit. I love interacting with him. And so I said, well, maybe I'll speak on the Holy Spirit. Nothing. God's silent. Silence. Don't hear nothing from God. God sneaks up on me in my room at times, right? When I'm not ready for him on my computer, and he starts talking to me, right? He might just come in and say, I want to teach you about righteousness. Now, I've been saved for years, and I thought, you know, I know something about righteousness, right? Not so. By the time, there's no teacher like the Holy Spirit. No teacher like the Holy Spirit. Well, before I go that direction, I have to go another direction. I have to thank the pastors for their support. My wife was in the hospital for close to maybe a year, over a year, for a long time. Pastor would call me. They would strengthen me. They would encourage me. Every time he called and you guys prayed, I can't go on preaching without telling you what prayer does. Amen. I'm going to give you just a little teeny bit. And also, I want to thank my children. They were great support. It was one of the hardest things I've ever went through. I don't have a backup plan. No chicks on the side, you know what I mean? This is it for me. That's it for me. So I told the doctor, I said, y'all better get with it. You know what I mean? Because I don't have no backup plans. Pastor will call me and say, all right, son, what do you need me to pray for? They talking brain surgery, Pastor. Okay, we're on it. I don't know how many times, Pastor, you called me. Every time it was exact right time. One by one, there were so many complications. In fact, we were in Jefferson Hospital, right? This is one thing that the Lord did. We were in the president's suite intensive care. So I thought they were joking, right? He said, well, y'all is lucky y'all got the president's suite. I said, yeah, right. He said, no, seriously. If the president comes in town right now, we would have to move your wife out. So our room was the biggest room up there. Secondly, God bless us to the point where I could stay. I could stay and see such favor. I've never seen such favor. Amen. I could stay up there day and night. Many times we stayed overnight, all kind of stuff. Thirdly, there's parking situations. At one point, I got a ticket. One point, somebody came up, stole my wife's iPad. Came in Jefferson. I don't know how they got through security. Came up to the ninth floor, stole her iPad, right? I'm going to tell you what kind of favor God had on her. Me and the security, we searched every floor. I want to make a long story short because there's a lot to it. Bottom line is, because we never reported it as valuable, they told us that nothing they could do about it, okay? Favor works. Detective came. He said, we can't find it, this, that, and the other. Bottom line was, not only did they pay for a new iPad, the person that stole the iPad gave it back. And they told us to keep it. So now I got an iPad and she got an iPad. That's only a little. I can't. My boss on my job, right? Our job is very disciplined, especially in the wintertime. You get in all kind of trouble if you don't show up, right? The bosses that fire you were calling me up. They give people 75. They give one young lady 75 days off of work from shooting basketball on company time. 75 days off. Can you imagine what that feels like? That don't include weekends. 75 days plus weekends, work days. They're calling me up telling me, we got you, right? My boss takes me into the person that schedules everybody, says, whenever this man comes in, you. Whenever this man comes in, he don't have to give you no notice. If he call you in the morning, he's off. That's your prayers. That's your prayers. Right? So one day I'm running. We had to get all different things, like a lift up taller. I don't know what you call it. It's higher. Like a, I don't, y'all know what it is, right? So I'm over here on 69th Street to the medical place. I'm rushing because my daughter's with my wife at the time. And they were so gracious. My kids were there around the clock. This was on and on and on. So I'm rushing, I stop at the red light, then I go through the red light. So the cop pulls up behind me, right? He said to me, he said, why did you go through the red light? I saw you stop. I said, officer, I'm going right through that medical place. I don't know what came over me. I feel like I'm under a lot of pressure because pressure comes from different ways, right? And so I said, but I have a CDL license, right? I said, officer, I don't really need a ticket that will interfere with my job. I said, but I don't mind paying the ticket if you could waive the points that were going against my CDL. So the officer said, you know what, I'll do that for you, right? Okay. So the officer says, I'll meet you in court, well, over here on Garrett Road, right? So I'm going there. Well, before that, I went in to get the taller, right? They gave me a paper from 19-something, and it was supposed to be $35. No, it said $35. When I got in there, the lady laughed, said, where'd you get this paper from? This is real old. The toll is $65. I said, oh, $65? She said, yeah, but you know what? I'm going to give it to you for $35. I'm talking about, that's only small. So I'm walking up to the courtroom, and a gentleman's coming and he's walking the other way. And the Holy Ghost say, hold the door for this guy. I mean, he's too far. I'm like, I'm trying to get in the court and sell him my business. He's too far to hold the door. So I do what the Holy Ghost say. Holy Ghost say, hold the door for him, I hold the door. I get in the courtroom, the police officer's not there. The judge come out. Guess who was the judge? So I had to prepay $135, right? I had to you know what the judge said? He didn't worry about the points or nothing. He said, give that man his money back. Go ahead home. That's only a few. That's what the prayers did. That's only a few. On and on and on and on. Your comfort, your prayers, your love. I wish I could come closer to each of you and just let you look in my eyes so you can see my heart for the appreciation I and my wife have for what you did for us. This is a great church. We have great pastors. And we're going to do great things, right? Now, I'm trying to think what I'm supposed to do next. I'm sorry. I don't have nothing written down. So, I'm thinking about where my sermon is going to go, right? Am I going to get a sermon or am I going to get a message? There's a little different. I'm thinking, well, I'm waiting. I'm still ain't got nothing. I'm waiting. I go to bed at 8 o'clock last night. 11:30, I'm wide awake. I haven't been back to sleep yet. Lord's just downloading stuff, but he's not doing it the way I'm used to it. Usually he puts a word in my belly. Or I get a word inside and I feel so full. Right, ministers? And till you release it, it just stays there. So usually my wife, she catches it all. And she says, you need to give that to people who need it. Like, it's got to go somewhere, right? If it's in there, it's got to come out, right? Struggling with a call all my life. Struggling as a man trying to balance a call with a family. That's difficult. That's very difficult. Because you want to do what God's telling you, but yet you have a family to take care of. You know what I mean? It's a difficult balance. So what the Lord started doing for me is opening up ministry on the job. Oh, God makes a way. Before that, I want to just say I got to finish talking with my pastors over here. And just finish thanking y'all. I'm sorry. I got to be me. And really, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I've come to have a new appreciation. You pastors, that's all. I mean, I don't know what else to say. Every time y'all were there. Every time y'all were there. Then to the elders. I've come to love these men. To the senior elder, I like what Pastor called Elder Reed, to the senior elder and his precious wife, Alfreda, and to the elders. I love these brothers. You know something? I'm just sitting in the back and I watch and I thoroughly enjoy myself. As big as these brothers is, I watch them cut a rug and I'm just rejoicing. I'm like, Brother Smith is one of the biggest men in the house. When he get before God, he like a little baby. I'm like, look at that brother there. We got men in here that are not afraid to praise the Lord. Not afraid to praise the Lord. That's a blessing. I'm so blessed. These brothers came. Some of them visited us in the hospital. They were such an encouragement, such a strength. The messages, off the hook. We ate well. Every time I came here, I ate well. See, I know the difference between a hot dog and filet mignon. And we had top shelf. Y'all boys put some nice word out. The way the Lord used y'all and the way that y'all, he allowed y'all to put the messages together, awesome. 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 I don't eat from everybody, by the way. And everybody can't feed me. I'm not trying to be funny or arrogant. Everybody can't feed. Even a lot of these big names up there, amen, they got a lot going on, but no anointing. Amen. And no humility. Thank you, elders, for being there. To the intercessors, I'm going to take my time. Is that all right? Amen. To the intercessors, thank you for your prayers. Thank you for calling our name out over and over and over and over again. I was down real low. Real, real low. You know, we like to always think we can be strong. You know what I mean? We really do. But some things come and you just get weak. You get tired. You can't even hold your own head or shoulders up. But God sends a body to support y'all. Now, in that light, I want y'all to remember what y'all did for me, do it for everybody.
Amen.
Do it for everybody. When the love flows the same from the least, or what we consider the least,
yes,
to the greatest,
yes,
you'll see this church grow like never before. When everybody is important, when everybody is somebody, when we can undergird each other, when we can intercede for each other, we might not be here today. Me and my wife, I don't know if it wasn't for your prayers. They had so many tubes coming out of my wife, it wasn't funny. I didn't even know they had tubes to put in certain places. They had machines hooked up on her head, front, back, IVs, all kinds of stuff. Oh, it was serious. I didn't even know she could have passed away. God shielded me from that. God shielded me. But in my heart, I never believed it was going to happen anyway. You understand what I mean? Not that I'm a great man of faith. I'm saying, God, you ain't going to leave me this way. I got enough problems. I need a help me. I need a help me. So I'm going to tell you about a little discussion me and my wife had, right? So we kind of funny. We, even though we're not real old, we're old, but not real old. We have like crazy discussions, right? So we're laying in the bed, because sometimes we just, when we ain't got nothing to do, we just chill. It ain't even about a wrestling match. It's just about being near each other. You understand what I'm saying? So we laying there. Sometimes we hold hands. Sometimes we look in each other's eyes. Sometimes we hug each other. And there's nothing better than that. Our love has matured over the years. She's been with me through thick and thin. We started out in efficiency with 3 kids for 5 years. 6 years. She knew better than I know. Because she wanted to get out of there. And I don't blame her. I was doing the best I can. You know what I mean? I took every job they would give me. And in that time, and I'm speaking to men a little bit about marriage, we learned each other because there was no place to run.
Amen.
And we believe the Bible where it said, don't let the sun go down upon your wrath. So there's no other room to run to when you have, we didn't have a lot of arguments. No, we didn't. But everybody have arguments. Argument just means two people don't agree. But see, you learn from that. You learn through the school of hard knocks. We went everywhere together. Everywhere we went, we took our kids.
Amen.
We didn't have a whole lot of babysitters.
Amen.
We raised our kids in the Word.
Yeah.
You understand me? I took the lead as the man of the house. I gave my kids devotion. I wasn't no great nobody, but I got down on my knees and I brought my, and I taught my kids how to pray. So we were in church one day and I didn't even know. The minister called us out and he said, come here. And we came up. God says he sees that altar in your house. Keep it there.
Yes, sir.
I said, what altar? Not even thinking, when you're just doing what you know to do. You don't think of it as a pat in the back. You don't think like you're doing something great.
Yes.
You're doing only what God told you to do, right?
Amen.
Right?
Yes.
I don't want to get ahead of myself. I'm just talking right there. I'm just talking. I don't want to miss nothing. So, like Pastor said, it's funny when you lay down and God tells you what to say, and then when you get up here, it's like, what did you say again?
Amen.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So, There's a few things that's on my heart. One of the things that God wouldn't let me, he was dealing with me out of Hosea. Now, I'm not really like a big time Old Testament guy. I love the Old Testament, don't get me wrong. But I stay in the New Testament a lot, you know what I mean? And I'm not a theologian, definitely you can tell that, I'm not. But he kept dealing with me with Hosea and wouldn't let me go. So I'm looking for a sermon and he keeps taking me back to Hosea. Back to Hosea, back to Hosea, back to Hosea. So I'm reading in Hosea. Let me see if I can find it. I'm gonna try to get this together. I know I'm a little bit all over the place, but. Yeah, I gotta do that. One thing this suit is hindering me. You know I don't like no. Oh, mercy. I'm doing the best I can do. Yeah. So I'm not gonna read it. I'm just gonna share a little bit about it. So God tells Hosea in chapter 1 to marry a prostitute. Y'all don't think that's strange? You know, y'all been reading the Bible so long, y'all used to it. You know what I mean? You can read the Bible so long where you don't get no revelation no more. Where it don't bother you no more. Like, this is a normal situation. He tells a prophet that hears from him to marry a prostitute. Now, according to the law, she's an adulterous woman. It don't even make sense. But sometimes when we're doing what God says, when we want to obey God, it don't always make sense.
Amen.
Right? 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 When we're really, really, really following the Spirit of God, it don't make sense. I give you a for instance. I'm at my job. I'm walking through the yard. And I work with some pretty rough customers. You know, the MF is a normal word. It's a social word at my job. You know. And so I don't want to go into detail, but it's pretty some real, real, real rough customers. So God says to me, he says, I want you to start a Bible study in there. And I did this like Elder Reed did. I said, you know what I said to God? And out of no disrespect, I said, God, if you want a Bible study in there, you got to start. These boys do cocaine. These boys drinking big liquor, not little liquor. They drinking big liquor on the job. They ain't playing no games with theirs. So I go in and I just leave it alone, right? God speaks to me. So we're sitting there. And one day this guy comes in, right? He's talking about the Bible, but he's talking all this crazy stuff about the Bible. Right there you go, right there, right? But I ain't say nothing. I ain't say nothing. I ain't talk crazy. He talking crazy. And one of the other guys sitting there saying, that what you saying ain't in the Bible, that ain't right. Then he looks at me and says, we need a Bible study in here. Right? Watch this. I still ain't said nothing. Then he points at me. I don't see how serious they are. They say, he points at me and said, next Tuesday we're going to have Bible study in here. I said, all right then. God started a Bible study on a job. The same room where cocaine was snorted on the desk. The same room where liquor was drank all the time. All right, so we got something like y'all got here, Pastor. Tight men group. Sometimes pastors come down. And you know what? They're disarmed because it's not church. Them brothers come like they are. Say what's on their mind. You know what I mean? A lot of times they curve their mouth. You understand?
Yes.
But little by little, we start seeing God move. Sometimes the supervisor pop in. What y'all doing in here? Sit down and stay and listen. Right? Pastors have come. Sit down and listen. People who retired have come. People that go to other churches have come. Now, I'm not trying to make more out of this than this, because a lot of times there's no more than 10, maybe 15 guys. That's a lot? Okay. It's a lot. They say it's a lot. But it's what God is doing. People are able to open up because there's no pretense. Sometimes people are scared to come in church. Right? Because when they get me in there, what them church people going to do to me? They go, I know they want me to do something. Stand up, sit down, jump around. And right, they still got that worldly spirit in them. They ain't feeling none of that. They ain't feeling that, all that we feel. We for God. We rejoicing in the Lord. We glad. They ain't feeling none of that. So to reach them, as you, a lot of you know, we gotta be where they are. Not try to be different. Got another praise report. Yesterday we went over to the homeless ministry. And by the way, it's not Brother Sonny's ministry, in case y'all don't know that. It's a ministry from Fresh Anointing. Y'all are welcome. We need all the help we can get. But God is moving. Seven people gave their life to the Lord over there yesterday. Look, it's a government agency, right? It went from just feeding to Bible study. They treat us like from Bible study. Almost preached in there last week. Almost, right?
Next week.
He said next week. And people are being touched. They got more respect when the prayer. Some of them come say, I can't wait for the prayer. We started out just praying, right? Before they eat, we just started praying. So one of us pray. Most of the time it's one of my sisters, because she's been the designated prayer. She do pretty. She do all right. You know what I mean? But she got a heart for God. And they can hear the cry. And they just get just as quiet. And they suck up off that prayer. They suck up off that prayer. We're planting seeds that we're looking for God to bring in the harvest. We're planting seeds because we're looking for God to bring a harvest. Right? We're in a consecration. We're in our worship. We're getting directed from our pastors because we're looking for what? For God to bring a harvest. Now, I got to go a little bit into this, not much. Now, a lot of things I've known for a long time, I just never say. Because you don't say everything God tell you. You just wait on him. And then sometimes you arguing with God anyway. Not like we can actually argue. Sometimes God is just so good to us that he know we don't know no better. You know, he know we're not disrespecting him. We don't see how, where, or why. But the word about this Hosea that God was giving me is that Hosea was a relationship, right? Between a husband and an unfaithful woman, Gomer, right? And Hosea. That's one thing it was. Two, it was prophetic, right? Because it spoke of how much God loved his people, regardless of all in the state that we see in the church today. God loves his people. We can't, because we get sometimes mixed up in doctrine, mixed up in prosperity, mixed up in carnality, mixed up in marketing, mixed up in all these things. God loves his people. I don't know. You know, I watched the movie Superman. You remember when with Christopher Reeve, right? I heard a preacher say one time, he said, if God has any weakness, it would be for praise. I had to disagree with him. He might be right, but I don't think God's weakness is for praise. He don't have no weakness. But I said, in my estimation, they watched Superman. He's fighting three villains. He getting the best of them. He was doing, you know, Superman was holding his own. And there was a guy on there named Zar. And Zar said, I'm going to make Superman kneel before me. But he couldn't do nothing with Superman. So they start throwing cars and stuff at people. And Superman would run over and grab the cars for people, and then they could jump on Superman. His weakness was for people. I say, I'm not saying it's right, but if God got a weakness, it's for people. Why? What is man that thou art mindful of him? If God got a weakness, it's for people. The Holy Spirit say in my spirit that we need the same weakness.
Come on, sir.
If God got a weakness, it's for people. He loves people. He loves the murderer. Come on, prison ministry. He loves the drug addict. Come on, Fresh Recovery. He loves the homosexual. He loves the gangbanger. And he loves me and you. Yeah, don't he? So he used this illustration with Gomer and with Hosea, the show, because they got caught up in a, if you read it, take some, if you got time, read it. They got caught up in a lot of stuff. He names it all in there. It would take me too long to read it all. I wouldn't want to prolong. But he names how they got away, how she went out a whoring and represented Israel. You can also refer to the church, how they got caught up and how they got out there. I know this in my spirit better than I know anything else, that God has a special work. Before I came to this church, I'm not a church. I don't play church too good. I don't do church real good. You know what I mean? Church is just too much for me. Not the body of Christ, not the move of the Spirit of God, just church. Church. What's become the organized church? What's become the big eyes, the little U's? What's become who's who? Who's who, but you ain't got no anointing. You got a doctorate, but you can't cast out devils. You understand what I'm saying? Thousands of people, but you can't get nobody filled with the Holy Ghost. You talking about the kingdom? You want to see the kingdom? Let the Holy Ghost loose. Let him loose. He'll mess everything up and put it back together right. The Holy Ghost always mess with me. I just be minding my business. I don't know why he messes with me, but I'm glad he does. I'm real glad about it. Real glad about it. Religion, I've been through Baptist church. I've been through every move from Christian God, demons. I've been through all the moves, all the conventions. I've been all of them. I didn't sit underneath all of them. I watched manipulation. I watched the power of influence. All these things that people don't even realize they're being manipulated by. You can't get away from the basic doctrine, and that is Jesus Christ. That's the foundation. And people go with everyone the doctrine. He say this, and it sounds slick, and because he's all dressed well and speaks good, we fall for the okie doke. There's nothing. Jesus Christ is the foundation. And the Holy Spirit is in charge. So many people have not let the Holy Ghost. That's why we don't see no crackhead. I used to see people crying. Crying and crying and crying. Sin just being purged out of. Now people come to the Lord smiling and waving. Like it's a social club. You know what they say? I'm going to get saved next week. How you know you will get? You know what? I'm going to tell you something. Without conviction, there's no salvation. You have to be convicted. You have to relate to what Jesus did on the cross for you. You have to understand that he paid for your sin, that he died and that he rose again for your justification. You got to realize who Jesus is. And I'm going to tell you, once you do, he can deliver you from anything. I seen some things now. I didn't walk through some things. I didn't walk through some tough areas. I've been delivered from some stuff. I like to keep it quiet, but I might have to tell it. I ain't got nothing to hide. Tell you a little story. I've been in trouble before, right? Why not get in some more trouble? So, I'm gonna hang real loose with y'all. Before me and my wife got married, yeah. That's what happened. It all happened. Right? Right? Oh, y'all wanna act like y'all already did everything right? No, I'm not proud of it. I felt like I wanted to die.
Amen.
So the conviction was strong, and then the daggone condemnation got me. From the enemy that tried to not allow me to come back to God. That went on for like a year. Right? Now, I wasn't never like a pervertish guy or nothing like that. You was? All right. I will tell nobody. It's for the glory of God.
He delivered me.
He delivered me. That's a good thing, right? Deliverance is the good part. Through that door, I got bound by lust. Yeah. I wasn't watching porno. I wasn't looking at dirty magazines. I opened the door. I was saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. And God had warned me. And I messed up. I wasn't a player. I wasn't smooth. I had no condoms in my pocket. It was two people that loved each other that didn't have instructions that they needed from their parents.
That's right.
And was in by themselves too long.
Yeah. Right.
You get tired of stamping tracks. I wish it was at least one person in there with us. It might not have never happened. Right? So, I'm coming up the steps, right? This is the tricky part. We were in Miracle Temple, Pastor.
Oh, wow.
So you know I was in trouble, right? So, I'm coming up the steps and I hear my mom talking to my aunt. Oh, everybody should be like Sonny and Al. They are so holy. That's an example of how everybody should date in court. So you know what happened to me, right? Conviction. So I went to the room. I said, Mom, look, I can't let you believe that lie. I said, ain't been nothing holy. I said, we fell into sin and we done got ourselves in trouble. Right? So as my mother was, she was, if you knew her, or if you didn't know, you might, a lot of you might don't know her. She was a woman of prayer.
Amen.
Extreme prayer. My mom could pray you out the bed.
That's right.
I know because I ain't had no phone, and she would pray, and I get hot all over. Then I go, Mom, you call me. You. She said, yeah, I sent the Holy Ghost after you. I said, okay, what you want? So through that ordeal, I became bound. Okay, I'm going to tell you how good God is. So my mother started praying, interceding. How important intercession is, even where we're going as a church. God, that intercession has to prepare the ground way for our pastors, right? The worship has to clear the airways, right? We got to take over this neighborhood. Y'all know that, right? It's going to be white and black and Chinese and Spanish and, right? God looking for a multicultural church. You never seen worship until you see a multicultural church, right? Right? It's going to be the down and out, and we can't turn our nose up at them. We can't, we got to say, sit right here next to me, and maybe if we got two suits and we don't like the way they dress, maybe we should give them one of ours. Hey! So my mom starts praying. And man, she prayed. When she prayed, man, she prayed. You get all down in here. She praying all out of here. Some of y'all just praying out y'all mouth. Some of y'all got rehearsed prayers, your favorite prayer. I remember one day I was at I was somewhere and this guy prayed. I said, man, that guy can pray. I wish I could pray like that. So I said to him, I said, how did you learn how to pray like that? He said, I memorized it. I said, oh. Memorize. Right? If you can't feel your prayers, neither can God. The effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous avails much, makes God's mighty power available. Prayer covering, you know what? I'm going to tell you a little secret. And I don't know. Yeah. I know how to get prayers from people. I know how to walk underneath prayer coverings. I can feel it when it comes. I don't know if it's a spiritual gift. I don't think it's a gift. I can feel it. I can feel when my wife's praying for me. I can feel when my mother-in-law's praying for me. I can feel when you're praying for me. Sometimes it gives me revelation. Sometimes it gives me a word to say. For instance, I walked in our brothers and sisters, we call them, at the homeless ministry. I ain't had nothing to say. I was tired. I didn't feel like saying nothing. So one sister says, come here. God told me to share this with you. Another sister, okay, come here. I want to share something with you. So they both shared something. I'm going back to my story. After they finished sharing with me, next thing I know, I'm sharing with the people. Yeah. Not what they said. The anointing that was in them quickened something in me. Yes. Reached down where I couldn't reach, brought it up, and it came out.
Yes.
And the people were edified. Back to the story. So my mom, we talked about this session, right? So my mom, as she prayed, God sent this brother who I didn't really know. I might have seen him one time before. I was standing on 14th and Walnut. On my way to church, my heart was hard. You can't sin and have a soft heart. I was bound because I was under condemnation. So I didn't run to God. And that's another thing. When you sin, that ain't none of the devil's business. That's between you and God.
Amen.
You run to God and you tell your father about your situation. You know another thing you do when you pray? If you got problems, tell him about it. I don't care what kind of problems you got. He'll listen to it.
Yes,
tell him just like it is. And he'll help you. He'll help you. He'll deliver you from issues. So this brother comes down the street, and he's one of my spiritual fathers also. Now, after that, he had become one of my spiritual, because he spoke so many things into my life that are manifesting today. I don't even know what he's talking about. Intercession like I've never seen. Can hear God from anywhere. He said I was in Florida, and God spoke to me and told me. No, he said, he came down the street, and he walked beside me. He said, how you doing? So I didn't really know him like that. I just gave him the nod. Like, keep going. So he says to me, what have you done? I said, what have I done? What's he talking about? So he says to me, I was in Florida, and the Lord spoke to me and told me one of my sons has fallen. Now, what have you done? So I began to share with him. Listen, this is a really important story. How I fell. I said I met a young lady I was in love with. I'm in love with, madly in love with, and we fell. So he said, mm-hmm. So I thought he was going to give me the Ten Commandments and throw the Bible at me and tell me how dirty and nasty and unclean and all this that I was. And you need to repent and get yourself together. He said, brother, let's pray. Right there on 13th and Walnut. Something about street ministry, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Ain't you glad God don't have to wait till you get to church on Sunday? Right? When you come here, you should already be full of God and spread some out.
That's right.
So he anointed both my hands and my forehead with oil. He had a little backpack. Now, he was one of the 10 best dressed men in Philadelphia. I seen him dress so sharp, it was ridiculous. And I seen him look so under, what you might say down, you would almost think he was a derelict. Because that's what his ministry called him for. He said, I go to the, God, listen to this. He said, I go to homeless shelters. God tells me to stay there. He said, and eat what they eat. He said, and if the food is not sufficient, pray and I'll change the menu. You talk about intercession. You talk about intercession. What would you do to see somebody delivered? You talk about the next, we're going to get there here. Because God got a lot of work. All right, so instantly, I couldn't even feel the presence of God. I felt a little trickle. I could feel the Holy Ghost just a little bit, but that's all I got. But I knew I was restored. Instantly it broke.
Amen.
Instantly it broke. I said, I don't feel the power of God in my life like I used to. What's wrong? He said, it's because you sinned. He said, it's just like a power on a stereo. He said, God turned it all the way down. He said, but keep walking with him, and he'll start turning it up again. Young people, listen to me. Don't think you can sin today and be right back where you were tomorrow. 4 years before God began to deal with me again. Oh, I was in fellowship. I felt relationship, but that anointing had to lift. That, you better come on here now. It's Jesus is precious. He said, look, you fell this time. Don't never let it happen again. And it didn't. You can't play with sin. I don't care what they tell you. God ain't got no greasy grace. Grace is not a license to sin. It's the power to live right. Right? Not a license to sin. All right, listen to what I'm saying. I was restored, but I was still bound by lust. That don't sound right, do it. That don't sound right, do it. Right? Because there's stages of deliverance. All right? Watch how good God is. I'm in Miracle Temple Pastor. I'm sitting on the back row trying to hide. All the way in the back. Preacher came from Italy. Shambach used to have all kind of preachers come through there. Anointed men of God, like we have here, right? So I said, ain't no way. So I'm looking at him, and he's Italian and his English is broken, right? You can understand what he said, but that's how much Italian he was, I'm trying to say. He wasn't American Italian. He was Italy Italian. That's a different, yeah. So I'm in the back in the safety zone, in the middle, just in case he come near the end. Not thinking he would ever walk from the front of the church all the way to the back of the church. Why do God work like he worked, right? Now I can see on his face, and I'm not trying to be funny, a glow. You can see that sometimes. When somebody really, when y'all, this consecration, when y'all really purge yourself out of self, when you deny yourself, the glory of God, the power of God, you can feel it in you. He walked all the way to the back of the church, and he said, "You, right there." I had to do that one, right? I had to do that one. Because everybody in the church knew me. I was embarrassed. This is Brother Sonny. He's a good brother. You know what I mean? Not that that went to my head, but I just don't want everybody to know what I did. I had some problems. Plus, I didn't like going up to the front of the church. That was embarrassing. So he said, God said, no, you, young man sitting right there. He said, God told me, come up front and I'll deliver you. I knew that was true. But you know what I did? I sat there. I sat there. From that point, I struggled with lust maybe 15 years. Oh, it didn't have power over me. Because I was filled with the Holy Ghost. I didn't watch no pornography, do all kind of crazy stuff. But I could feel it. Sometimes it would come on me. I could feel it like, and try to make me weak. And I would have to, I didn't know my authority in Christ. And on top of that, it because of the anointing that was on me, it couldn't overpower me, but it would harass me. So I did I went to all the big conventions. I'm going to get this thing off of me. But I disobeyed God, so I had to suffer. See, I didn't take my way out, so I had to go the long way. God will give me the short way, but I had to go the long way. Now watch this. So I see the people up front praying hard, like Sister Jeanette and them do. Up hard, they praying hard back and forth before the convention, right? So I said, I'm going to get up there to them. They praying hard. So I asked one sister, I said, can you pray for me? She said, what's the problem? I said, lust is the problem. She said, well, you got to talk to one of the men about that. All right, well, whatever you say. I go, where's the men? So I go back to the men that pray hard, right? And I told them, I said, can y'all help me pray for me? I got lust. So he said to me, are you married? I said, yeah. He said, that should solve your problem. The worst answer he could have ever gave me. Because my problem had nothing to do with my wife. It was a door that had opened and nobody could show me how to close it. Come on now. And I had to. So Pastor used to always preach a message. I used to love this message he preached. The yoke shall be destroyed because of fatness. The yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. So it took years. So I had to get in the word. I get in the word. I spend hours in word, hours in prayer, till finally it broke. Hallelujah. Finally it broke. Right? So there are different ways to be delivered. There's the laying on of hands. There's you can be prayed for, right? But you can also get in the word and you can and you begin to close doors. You have to close door. Whatever you're going through, whatever's plaguing you, whatever's binding you, you got to close doors. Put you on the Lord Jesus Christ. Make not provisions for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof, right? I got in that word and I got in the word and I start seeing about sin. And I start seeing about righteousness. And I start seeing about grace. And I start partaking of the things of God. And I buried myself in the word till it broke off of me. There's a lot of tricks out there. There's a lot going on. There's a lot out there in the streets. These young people are facing stuff we never faced. Yeah. Old people acting like young people. Where the old should be teaching the young. But I'm going to tell you this, and this a little bit directed to the young people. Get rooted and grounded in Christ. Let Christ dwell in your heart. Give Christ your affection. Don't be by all this stuff you see on TV and these rappers and all these people propagating the fraud and all this stuff. You don't want your life to go like them. Look for people that live in godly lives. It's easy to do wrong. You know, it takes a while to build a building. It don't take no time to tear it down. Right? When you're in Christ, believe that he's precious. Jesus is precious. Get to know him. He wants to get to know you. He'll speak to you. He will actually speak to you. Okay. I'll give you, how much, almost, I got to get ready to stop, right? I'm actually just getting started, but I'm getting ready to stop. So, God takes a person like me. I'm getting ready to wrap it up. God takes a person like me who don't know nothing, don't got nothing going on, too tough, right? I'm in CLC. So I walk by this guy, and God says to me, he's looking for a church. I don't know this guy. I'm like, God, I keep going. I'm saying, God, if you're saying that, then I don't know. So I'm going to CLC. I'm doing what I got to do. When I went back to the front of the store, the guy's standing there. He says, do you know where I can find a church at? I said, here go God again, always, right? So I said, yeah, come to me. I said, come with me. So he came to Fresh Anointing. Me and my wife would pick him up every week, bring him. Then the Lord spoke to me and said, he's not going to be there long. That's not it wasn't the church for him. So one Sunday I go to pick him up. He's not on the corner. Well, we picked him up every week. African brother. So he calls me later on. I said, Simplex, I came to pick you up. Where were you? He said, I'm going to another church now. Right? That's the Lord. That's how the Lord moves. Share one more really personal thing to my heart that God did for us, did for me. I got the Holy Spirit. In this season or this time, we have to be very conscious of the move of God's Spirit. So we have to pray hard for our pastors because they don't have an easy job. Yes. They might not tell you, and they didn't tell me either, but I'm sure there's times they wanted to give up. I'm sure it's time just, can I just get a break? You know, you understand me? I have a hard enough time just taking care of me. You understand me? That's a full-time job. And trying to do the little stuff I do, I'm trying to learn how to be a grandfather. Amen. I'm not that good at that. And I know I'm not. I'm praying. I'm asking God to help me because I had no example. And that's not an excuse. I got people praying for me. I'm going to be good after a while. Right? Right? And y'all pray for me. Y'all pray for me. What was I talking about? I forgot what I was talking about. Who? Siblings. Okay, the last story. Thank you, sister. Y'all know I got some timers, right? I'm not confessing that, but sometimes I just forget. Anyway. So I'm late for church once. Well, I've been late for church more than once, but I'm late for church this Sunday. The head station on City Line. I'm going in there. I say, I got to hurry up and get this gas. I got to get to church. So I have a daughter and pray for my daughter that has special needs. She's been through a lot. She's been to every mental institution probably in the city of Philadelphia, even as far as Texas. God has been, in spite of all she's been through, God has been there for us. She's been missing for weeks at a time. Out of nowhere, God shows us where she is. I'm not exaggerating even a little bit, not even a little bit. One time I was out working, she walks right past our job. The police couldn't find her for weeks. Another time she was all the way up King of Prussia. She walked there. Other times she lay in the middle of the street and won't respond when I talk to her. And right where traffic is. Different, she's been through many phases, but God has been faithful through it all. It's a tearing, it's a learning. So me and my wife have been through mental institution after mental institution, and we find, I gotta hurry up. There's a whole lot of ministry in different places that need to be, and that's what God is getting us ready for. There's a whole lot of ministry. He ain't sitting up here with all this praise that we're getting and all this glory that's coming down for us to hog it to ourselves. There's people out there that need this, and you got it. You got it. God wants to motivate you to get out there and reach these people. So I'm sitting there and doing a little dancing around the music, and I'm a little. Oh, sometimes I need help too. I said, they like music? That's what I said. I said that to myself. You know, like, not enough, but I just didn't know, you know, until I started being around more and more. When you start getting around people and you start to know people, God can start working compassion in your heart and start seeing the situations happen to people, that everybody's not as privileged as everybody, that some people didn't choose, it was chosen for them, that situations. So I'm in a head station. And I walk through, and here goes the Holy Spirit again. He says to me, he says, there's a young girl sitting right where the cars go to get the gas. She's big, but I can see on her face the look of Down syndrome, right? So God said, go over and help that young lady. I almost laughed. I'm not trying to be funny. It seemed like God insulted me. I said to God, I can't even help my own daughter. How can I help that young lady? Watch this. All this happened in the flash of a moment because my mind is getting to gas. I'm glancing over. I'm looking. I see her sitting there. I see a young woman trying to get her up and a woman that looked like her mother, and she won't move. She's sitting there with her legs crossed on the ground where the cars come to get gas, right behind their car, and they can't get up. They're talking to her. They're speaking to her. They can't get her up. So I go and pay for my gas. I go back, and I'm getting ready to get out of there. I'm getting ready to come to church. And God said to me, all the things you've been through, what has it done for you? He says, is your heart hard or is your heart soft? I said, God, then I'll do it. So I go over to approach them, right? So as I'm looking at the young lady's face. She's well-dressed and a younger woman. And our look on our face is like, oh, what is this guy coming over here for? You know what I mean? Maybe because the look on our face like, because I may be an attractive guy, he's acting like he wants to help. That was the first thing from my mind. So I go over, I said, do you need any help? She said, no, we all right. So I turned right back around and went. And as I walked, God told me to speak to the mother. I don't know why. So I spoke to the mother. And I said, what's wrong? She said, that's my daughter, and we can't get her up. I said, what's her name? So she told me her name. So just say, Vicky. I forget now. So I walk over and I say, Vicky, do you want to get up? She took my hand and jumped right up. Mm-hmm. I was shocked myself. I couldn't believe it. So I walk away and the lady calls me because now they're trying to get her in the car, but she won't get in the car. So they can get her out of there. She's standing right in front of the car like this. So she says, sir, can you come back? She said, for some reason, she responds to your voice. It wasn't my voice. How many know it wasn't my voice? Yeah. She said, do you mind asking her to get in the car? I said, Vicky, would you get in the car? She got right in the car just like this and said, you know what I did? I went in my car and started crying. I said, God, what are you saying to me? God has a way no matter what we go through. If we see him, if we trust him, if we believe him. My wife, one of my wife's favorite scriptures is in the Message Bible. If you hold on for dear life, I'll get you out of any trouble. I'm closing with that. I just want to tell y'all thank you again. I love you. Pray for me. This church is going great places. Going great places, Pastor. Something I wanted to say to you, dear Pastor. I'm sorry. It had to do with what's going on now and the consecration and the worship. And that was, that prophetic word was, right, you know, a blessing. I don't have to say it. You the pastor, you know. That the door is open, fresh anointing. Before I came here, I asked God about pastor. What you talking about? I asked God about the fresh anointing, the direction it was going to go in. Not because I'm a little bit of an intercessor. I'm not the intercessor my wife is, but I'm an intercessor. And God said to me concerning pastor, it's the, one of the reasons through the easy times and the hard times I was able to stay. And it's good to go through. We've been through a lot of transition. Thank you for hanging in there. Amen. Right? Amen. Right? Amen. Right? Amen. Right? This is what God said to me. When I asked God concerning pastor, he said, he is my servant. He will do what I tell him to do. That was what God told me. Right? And he told Pastor Jay that. She said it. She came up in the pulpit. I was almost outdone. Second, Pastor Jay went further to say that they weren't the first choice, but they chose to be obedient. The next thing I asked God about this church was, why another church? This is what I need to tell you. This is the crust of the message. God wants this church to be a prototype. A prototype. There's a whole lot of churches that are doing church as usual. Locked in and they can't even see it. But there's a direction that God, we have to get behind, and the intercessors got to pray this through. The elders, we got to back up pastor. It's time to get this job done. It's time to get this job done. This church is called to be a prototype. Now, we're able to stay here for a number of reasons. One is our worship. The worship here is off the hook. What? The worship here is heavenly. The worship here is atmospheric. I'm trying to say that word right. Did I say that pretty good? Yeah. The worship here is one reason. The next is our intercession, and that's why pastor and them have us in prayer mode. See, we got to win it in the spirit. When you start winning in the spirit, people are coming off the streets and don't even know why. Right? The spirit has to be broken off of this area. And as we are obedient, breakthroughs will come not only in this atmosphere, but in us. Doors will be open in us. We're praying up, the answer will come down. Angels will start to go forth because now we're in alignment with the Spirit of God. That's what the real crux of this message was. The crux of this message was that God loves his people. Yeah. The crux of this message is that God wants us to go out and get his people. God calls them his people who were not his people, right? Her beloved, which were not beloved. God wants us to go, right? Last thing, and I got to stop because I can go on and on. Lester Sumrall said there was a girl that was biting people or had bite marks or something on her. Some of y'all might have heard the story. She was in the witchcraft in one of those foreign countries. So God said to Lester Sumrall, I want you to go down in that country and get that girl delivered. Lester Sumrall said, why should I go, God? You probably got people down there that could do it. God told Lester Sumrall, if you don't go, I don't have nobody that can do it. If we don't do what God wants us to do, oh, maybe he'll raise somebody up, but 40 years later? Right? Right? An open door, right? An open door. Look, ain't, we, we're not no special people. Ain't none of us in here. But God uses base things, right? All we got to be is obedient, right? All we got to do is say, yes, Lord, right? Here am I, use me. You don't have to be eloquent in speech. You don't have to be a theologian. You don't have to know the whole Bible. All you have to have is a heart for Jesus and a love for God. Right? Yes. Yes. That's all I got.
If you heard what God said, would you stand and give him praise? Yeah. He preached my heart. He preached my desire for this church. And what he preached on today, I believe in God's going to do it in 2017. God loves people. He has a heart for people. He wants to reach people. He wants to hug somebody, but he has no arms but yours. He wants to tell somebody that they're loved, has no mouth but yours. I pray that you'll catch the vision, that you'll catch a desire for people. First of all, for each other. Because it's got to start in here. Amen. And then for the people outside these four walls, for the community. That's who Jesus died for. That's what God cares about, people. There's nothing else to say. Everything that needs to be said has been said. I want to thank God for Sonny Adens. As every head is bowed today, every eye is closed, God loves people, and that means God loves you. He cares about you. That's why he sent his only son to die for you. So if you're here today and you don't know Christ and the pardoning of your sins, you might be a Hosea, a Gomer, but God loves you. And he wants you to know that he loves you with an unconditional love. Some of us have been looking for love in all the wrong places. I found that you will only find it in Christ. So if you're here and you have never received Christ, or you're backslidden, or you fell out of fellowship, or you are Gomer, living an unrighteous life, if you find yourself in that situation, we want to pray for you that you might receive Christ today. So if you are not saved, not born again, don't know Christ, don't know where you're spending eternity, as the heads are bowed and the eyes are closed, I'm going to ask if there's one to raise your hand, say, pray for me, preacher. Pray for me, I'm outside the ark of safety. I don't know Christ as my Savior. If you're backslid, you knew the Lord, but you fell away, We will give an invitation to you to come as well. Hallelujah. I thank God that God loved me in spite of myself. He loved me when I was unlovable. Is there one today? If not, amen. Some of you might be already saved, and you might have come back to the Lord, but you are without a church home. You don't have any place where you can worship on a regular basis, where people will love and encourage you, support you. You don't have that. And maybe the Lord touched your heart today, saying, you know what, I need to be part of that fellowship. I need to be part of that church. I'm already saved. I already know the Lord. I know I'm going to heaven, but I just need a home where I can be, where I can sit under the Word. And maybe that's you today. You need a church home. You need to be under a pastor or pastors. If that's you,